Very good morning to all of you. I think this is the first session of the day, so all of you are very fresh and ready to grasp some good technical knowledge. Good. So as part of my presentation, I am going to cover this different architectural approaches for providing multi-tenancy. But before I start onto that, let me start with a brief overview of cloud computing, because multi-tenancy is primarily used for cloud computing. So in its broadest uses, the term cloud computing refers to delivery of scalable IT resources over the internet, as opposed to hosting and operating them locally, such as on a college or university network. Now, these resources can include applications, services, as well as the infrastructure on which they operate. Now, by deploying these resources over the internet, organizations can purchase them on an as-needed basis and avoid the capital cost of software and hardware. For example, Service Desk is an application provided by CA via its cloud platform, which can be used by the organizations to raise service request tickets for the CA products on cloud. Now, these organizations accessing the application over the cloud are referred as tenants for the cloud, and serving multiple tenants at the same time is called multi-tenancy. Now, if only one instance of an application is needed to serve multiple tenants, then such an application is called a multi-tenant application. Let us take an example where your organization is already having an application and there are multiple customers to this application. These customers have purchased this application and installed into their premises and they are using it happily. Suddenly one day your product owner comes to you and tells you, see, there is a requirement to provide this application to the customers via our cloud platform. So this application should support multi-tenancy. So what is the first question that comes into your mind? Is it like, what is the need of doing it? Yes. Or maybe, in other words, what are the benefits of a multi-tenant application? Now, to decrease the cost of delivering the same application to multiple sets of different users, an increasing number of applications are getting multi-tenant rather than single-tenant. While the traditional single-tenant application requires a dedicated set of resources to fulfill the needs of just one organization, a multi-tenant application can fulfill the needs of multiple tenants using the hardware resources and the staff needed to manage just one software instance. Now, multi-tenancy is an architectural approach that pays dividends to both the application provider and the users. Operating just one software instance yields a tremendous economy of scale for the application provider. Just one set of hardware resources are needed to fulfill the needs of all the users. A relatively small, experienced administrative staff can efficiently manage just one stack of software and hardware. Developers can build and support just one code base on one single platform rather than many. The economics afforded by multi-tenancy allows the application provider to provide the services at a lower cost to the customers, so everybody involved wins. Now, there are some interesting side benefits of multi-tenancy, that is improved quality, user satisfaction, and customer retention. Now, as compared to the existing traditional single-tenant applications, which are isolated silos deployed outside the reach of the application provider, a multi-tenant application is one large community hosted by the application provider itself. This design shift allows the application provider to gather operational information from the collective user population, such as which query runs slower, what are the general errors, and he can provide frequent incremental improvements to the services that benefits the entire user community at once. Now, when we have already looked at different benefits of a multi-tenant application, let us see how it operates. So while using a multi-tenant application, all tenants share the same operating system, hardware, and a single instance of middleware and application. This is accomplished by parameterizing the same application instance with the tenant identification parameter. Now, each tenant can have its own specific configuration elements like CSS file, etc. When a new tenant subscribes, tenant-specific configuration elements are created for that tenant. Now, to make it working, the application must be designed in such a way to provide the capability to isolate each tenant's data from the other tenants.
See,
Okay. So, scaling a multi-tenant application is similar to scaling any other application on the cloud. So, how do you scale? Either you scale up or scale out. So, if you are seeing that your application instance is efficiently working for 100 tenants and the performance is going down when you are adding more tenants, what will you do? Either you will scale up the same instance by adding more hardware, or you will scale out by installing a new instance of the same application for the next set of customers. For example, force.com is having around 8 instances of their multi-tenant application all over the world for serving around 43,000 of their customers. Now, let us see that Radhika, does that answer your question? Now let us see what all technical challenges you can face while designing a multi-tenant application. So one of the challenges is that how to authenticate users that belongs to different tenants. Now to handle that, what can be done is that on the login page, tenant user enters his username and password along with the tenant identification. The authentication module combines the tenant name and the username to authenticate the user. Once the user is authenticated, it creates a security session token for the user and it stores its tenant identification and the session information inside it. Now this security session token can be accessed by any module within the application at runtime. Another problem can be like how to process requests from different tenants. Now any thread within the HTTP thread pool can handle the request on behalf of any user from any tenant. At the start of the request, the thread context gets cleared and is switched to the appropriate tenant, and it remains fixed to that tenant for the duration of the request. Another problem can be like how to access shared resources. Now, if the application wants to access a shared resource on behalf of a tenant, it can simply raise the request. Now, instead of directly executing the request, it can be transferred to a common resource access module. It implicitly retrieves the tenant identification from the security session token for the request owner and creates a tenant specific filter based on some predefined rules. Now this module uses this filter to prevent each tenant from tapping into the resources that belongs to the other tenants. For an example, let us see how can we change the business object cache of a application to make it tenant aware. So one more thing, like business object cache is the shared resource between all the tenants for a multi-tenant application. Now in this example, there is a cache manager that manages different business object caches in parallel. Now to make it tenant aware, what you can do is that you can add a layer of tenant identification between the cache manager and the caches. So by doing that, each tenant will have its own parallel cache managed by the same cache manager. So the previous two-tier cache of the single tenant application has been converted to a three-tier cache to provide the multi-tenancy. It's an organization or set of users. So as I said in my previous first slide, like organizations can use the application over the cloud. Now obviously organization is a set of 100 or maybe more than 100 or 1000 resources or users. So it's a tenant is a set of users. Okay.
So will they be identified by a single user ID? Is one tenant given a single user ID to log on, or will there be a group of users who will have a single tenant ID? How does it work?
Yeah, so that's what, why for authentication, user will enter its username along with the tenant ID. So both will be combined. And then a security session token will be created for the user.
So what distinguishes
username and tenant ID, both are combined together for authentication.
Yeah.
So what user mean, what tenant mean, what is the distinguishing factor?
Like the same thing, like a tenant is a set of users. In multi-tenancy, tenant is a set of users. So previously, like in previous internet-based application, what used to happen? There are multiple users, they are accessing and that's all. Now when cloud has appeared, it's like many organizations can access. So this, to improve on scalability and other things, we have got this multi-tenancy architecture approach to to scale it for more number of organizations and all.
So now, so if I am running a small company and I get a tenant ID for myself and all my users will get a user ID, so when my data is processed, my the individual user ID who belongs to my organization plus the tenant ID will be used as a factor.
Right.
Like me, somebody else from here will be running their own company, all are sharing the same.
Yeah.
So tenancy means a business. And the user means individual business.
Yeah.
Name, so, group of
yeah. For example, Malar can be a user ID for multiple companies. So combine the tenant ID or the organization ID with the username to authenticate or identify the user.
Just to clarify this a little more for the questions around the tenant ID and the user ID, if you go down to the primitive database concepts, you know, there is a concept of a primary key, there's a concept of a foreign key, and I'm sure all of you would have heard of a concept of a composite key. A composite key is a combined key that you get out of combining two other keys, which are unique again in nature. So composite key again keeps it unique, but still has can be used as an identifier in the whole system. So tenant ID, as Malar was pointing out, is specific to the organization or the unit that is using it, and that combined with the user ID gives it to you, unique for that particular user. I hope that answers. Multiple businesses share the same, not the same data, but the same resources. On which the data is deployed.
Ah, yes. Then data privacy issues will come up.
We'll talk about it.
Yeah, we'll talk about it.
Thank you.
Thanks, Emma, for providing the answers. So, so when we have already looked at how to design a multi-tenant application, I have a question for all of you. So, suppose there is there are two banks accessing the same home loan application over the cloud. So, what do you think? How should we store the data for these two different banks in the database? Should we store data for all the users in the same database, or we should use separate databases? Why? Good. So because your application is going to store sensitive tenant data, the prospective customers will have high expectation about security. And this is the reason why it is the primary importance for the prospective SaaS architect to create a data architecture that is both robust and secure enough to satisfy the tenants and the customers who are concerned about surrendering their vital business data to a third party, while being both efficient and cost effective to administrator and maintain. Now the difference between shared data and isolated data is not binary. Instead it's more of a continuum with many possible variations between the two extremes. So here I'm going to discuss the three approaches for creating or providing multi-tenancy. Now the first approach is like using separate databases. So by using separate databases to store tenant data is the simplest approach for data isolation. Each tenant gets its own set of data that remain logically isolated from the data that belongs to the other tenants. Metadata associates each database with the appropriate tenant, and database security prevents each tenant from accessing the data that belongs to the other tenants. So what do you think? What are the benefits of this approach by having tenants' data in separate databases? Higher degree of data isolation, higher degree of security, right? Tenants can easily extend the application model to satisfy their individual needs.
But I have to pay more.
Yeah, I'll come to that point. Okay, so again, backup and recovery processes are very easy or simpler. So what are the consequences? Your higher cost of maintaining equipment and backing up data, higher cost of hardware, because the number of tenants that you can store on a database server is limited to the number of databases that it can support. Now, storing tenant data into separate databases is the premium approach, and because of its higher cost, this is appropriate for the customers who are ready to pay extra for the added security and the customizability. For example, customers in the area of banking and medical record management generally have a very high requirement of strong data isolation and may not even consider an application that does not provide each tenant with its own database. Now there is another approach, using separate schemas. So while using this approach, you can have more number of tenants in the same database, with each tenant having its own set of tables that remains logically grouped into a schema that is specifically created for that tenant. When a new tenant subscribes, tenant provisioning system creates a discrete set of tables for the tenant and associates that with the tenant's schema. Now, similar to the previous approach, this approach is easy to implement and tenants can easily extend the application's data model. Now, as compared to the previous one, this approach provides a moderate degree of data isolation and security and can store more number of tenants per database server. Now, this approach is appropriate for the application that uses lesser number of tables in the range of 100 tables per tenant or fewer. And this approach is appropriate when the, because customer can provide or application provider can provide and can have more number of tenants per database server, he can provide the services at a lower cost to the customer as long as they are ready to have their data co-located with the other tenants. Now, there is a third approach, that is using the same database and same set of tables. Now, by using this approach, all tenants share their data in the same database and same set of tables. Any table can have data for any number of tenants in any order. A tenant identification column associates each record with the appropriate tenant. So what do you think? What are the benefits of having multiple tenants in the same database and same set of tables?
Yeah. Because one SQL server costs so much.
Yeah.
So if I'm running a very small business, it's better not to pay for the entire SQL instance.
Yeah. If I could share it with others, my cost gets reduced.
Yeah. So lower cost of hardware, because it can support largest number of tenants per database server. Lower cost of maintaining equipments and backing up data. So what are the consequences?
Lower cost of software also.
Software also.
SQL Server software, I'm going to pay very less. I'm going to share it with the other tenants.
Thanks, Malar. Yeah, the consequences will come. So what are the consequences? Lower degree of data isolation, lower degree of security, right? And if you want to restore data in case of failure for a tenant, it's like a relatively complex procedure, because you need to delete individual records from the production database and reinsert from the temporary database. If the number of records are higher on the affected tables, then it may affect the performance adversely for all the tenants that the database serves.
I have a question.
So typically
different tenants have different data retention policies because of some compliance or, you know, audit related stuff. So in that case, which of these models do you think would be more easier to deploy and maintain in case you have, you know, different data retention policies to be implemented across tenants?
Yeah, if you want to provide tenant specific backup, restore, data retention and all these type of policies, it's always better to go for more separated, more isolated approaches, like for separate databases, separate schema. We are going to compare these approaches actually, okay?
Everyone has their own databases. So the approach one is like much similar to what we have traditionally. It's like every tenant is having their own database. That's what is happening now. So what's the difference that the cloud is providing when I have a high impact data and I want to use cloud?
Yeah, but at the application layer, they are still sharing the same infrastructure, right? We have only one.
From database perspective, we are not saving anything, only that the same code is running everywhere.
Yeah. Different level of, you know, isolation. If you want to provide, you have to pay extra, right? So and again, because all tenants share the same database and same set of tables, it may require additional development effort in the area of security to make sure that tenants can never access the data that belongs to the tenants, even in case of failure or unexpected bugs or attacks. Now, this approach is appropriate when it is important that application be capable of serving the largest number of tenants with the lowest number of resources, and the prospective customers are willing to surrender the data isolation in exchange of the lower price that this approach makes possible. Now, when we have already looked at the three data architecture approaches, let us see what all criteria you should consider before choosing an approach. So first is economic contemplations. So it has been seen that application designed for more shared approaches tends to require higher development effort than the application designed for more isolated approaches, resulting into higher upfront cost. But because they can support more number of tenants per database server, their ongoing operational cost tends to be lower. Security tenant contemplations. It's very obvious from the figure itself that if you have more number of tenants, you should go for more shared approaches. If the database size per tenant is higher, you should go for more isolated approaches. If the number of users per tenant is higher, then again you should go for more isolated approaches. And again the same thing, like if per tenant you want to provide value-added services like backup, restore and those kind of services, you should go for more isolated approaches. Okay? Security contemplations. Now your application is going to store sensitive tenant data, so your prospective customers will have high expectation about security, and your service level agreement will have to provide strong data safety guarantees. Now there is a common misconception that only physical isolation can provide appropriate level of security, while data stored using shared approaches can also provide strong data safety but requires uses of more sophisticated design patterns. Okay, so by now we have already looked at how to design and develop a multi-tenant application. Now if you are thinking, oh god, I have to make so many changes in my existing single-tenant application to make it multi-tenant, then don't worry. There is another approach which you can use without making any changes, that is virtualization approach. So while using a virtualization approach, each tenant has its own separate virtual image with different instances of operating system, middleware and application while sharing the hardware. Now when server virtualization is installed on a physical server, for each new tenant, the service provider instantiates a virtual server to host its tenant specific software, including its application and the middleware. Now there is one technical challenge in providing multi-tenancy, is that how to automate provisioning of new tenants. While using virtualization approach, service providers have to work with a potentially lengthy and complex installation and configuration steps for each new tenant. Now to help you on this problem, there are multiple products in the market, such as CAP Logic is one of such product, in which you can define templates for your templates for the hardware and the software stack for your application. It dynamically provides the infrastructure pieces required for the application on demand, assembles and configures them with your code on top. When you stop the application, it steers down the infrastructure and frees up the dynamic resources such as cache or CPU bandwidth, etc. So when we have already looked at the two major approaches, that's it, one is by creating a multi-tenant application, another by using virtualization approach, let us compare the two approaches to see that how can we, what are the benefits and the cost in the two approaches. So for a multi-tenant application, it can be easily scaled to a large number of tenants. Again, it's cost effective because infrastructure is shared between all the tenants. The costs are like you need to do redesign or code changes in your existing single-tenant application to make it multi-tenant. So it has higher time to market, higher upfront cost. Again, you need a good skill set in your resources to make this design changes and code changes. Now again, you want to provide tenant-specific backups and recovery kind of services, then it adds to the complexity. In the virtualization approach, the benefits are like no redesign is needed, so quick time to market. It provides better security and availability because each tenant is having its own virtual image. Higher degree of hardware and OS customizations because again, different virtual images for different tenants. Easy to relocate the application to separate platforms. Simpler backup and disaster recovery procedures. The costs are like it is lesser scalable because each tenant is having its own virtual image. Higher performance overheads. Higher operational and management costs because you have to operate and manage so many virtual images. So to conclude on that, I'll say is that Amazon AWS is multi-tenant at the hardware level. In that, its users might be using the same physical machine, while force.com is multi-tenant at the database level, in that its users share the same database and same set of tables. So while Amazon...
I have a question here. We are talking about multi-tenancy. Is it for a customer or is it for an end user?
See,
for a provider, service provider.
The customer should understand the trade-offs of not having multi-tenancy. They should understand that how the architectural decisions of a vendor can impact future pricing model, business object value, and business flexibility. And if a vendor can provide multi-tenancy, he can provide any range on the cloud platform, from on-premise to hosted mode to multi-instance and multi-tenancy. So is that answer to question? Thanks. Thanks, Radhika.
I hope you can hear me.
Sure.
Thanks, Soni. So I think that was a lot of discussion and a lot of enthusiasm also in the team here. I just want to mention one thing. Whenever we talk about cloud to the men community, they are either saying, okay, what's the benefit? Is there any cost advantage and things like that? But then they just zero it down saying, okay, it's all there. It's fine. Probably that experience of mine is because I also report to an executive in the organization who only thinks of money and costs and nothing. Of course, he's a technical person, but he does not want to think in terms of what is the advantage in terms of the value addition that you give to the customer. So let's take a quick look. I think as we move ahead, we will be covering some of the questions that you asked, basically in terms of should the database also should be shared, or how is it, how does cloud really work? There are answers to all the questions. Again, I want to point out the fact that cloud adoption is not a formula-based adoption. Okay, it's a lot of logical thinking that goes in, and you as an architect, what I'm going to talk about now is purely what do you do as an architect? How do you architect a cloud multi-tenant environment? So the decision process is what you will see here. And how many of you come with any design architecture background here? Excellent, I love this. Thank you. So let's see how it is. Now what we're doing here is basically, I'll have to stand here and walk around. I hope that's comfortable for you. So if you see this chart, this is basically a summarization of all that Soni just spoke about. So you start with the left-hand side, you talk about isolation. Isolation in the sense you have various stacks in your application. When you talk about stack, right from the database level to the user interface, you have various layers into which you transition or your transactions move into. So what are the different layers you actually can go ahead and isolate is what this end of the chart talks about. Let's come to the top section of it a little later. But then if you look at isolation, what does it mean? It means easier customization. Somebody was talking about dedicated databases. So this is what you mean by isolation. I cannot access another person's database because it's isolated to that environment. And similarly, your application server, your business logic, your workflow, your UI, all of that is completely isolated. I don't have time. He's showing me the chart. Okay, thank you. So isolation is all about that. And you talk about applications. Ever since our ages, we've been working on application, single instance, and client-server mode, and all these things are nothing but isolated applications, very, very specific to your customer business problem and your organization. But then as you start moving to the other side of it, we are talking about totally sharing whatever we have, sharing for cost advantage. So how much and to what level we share is what we will cover there. Now I want to get your focus a little higher up on the chart. Now cloud multi-tenancy is basically of four types. Okay, exactly catering to what the questions that you've asked for just now. So cloud multi-tenancy can be of four types. The first one, if you see, it is isolated tenancy. So when we talk about isolated tenancy, you have the infrastructure layer. Let me climb up a little. Is there a way I can point here? Can you see that here? You have the infrastructure layer at the bottom here. So when we talk about infrastructure, it is your hardware, it is your data center. Start with your data center first, and then it is your hardware, your network. All these are classified under what you call as infrastructure. Now, when you move up the stack a little bit, then you have your databases. So your Oracle database, SQL database, all these are hosted on top of these hardware. Of course, you have a hypervisor unit between the two. I hope all of you know what is a hypervisor. It's basically a translation mechanism between your virtual machine and the hardware. So that sits somewhere in between here. And then a little above the layer, you can see the green bar there, that is your application layer. So when you talk about application layer, your WebSphere server, your WebLogic server, all your application layer sits on top of that, and it interacts with your database. Of course, it interacts with it for, persistence. Okay, so that's the layer here. And then right above that, you have what is called the tenancy layer. So tenancy, we'll come to what that layer does. But then if you look at these four blocks or different ways of cloud multi-tenancy here, the isolated layer, if you see, there are three tenants out here in the first block, tenant one, tenant two, and tenant three. Each of them have their own vertical stack. They have their own application server, they have their own database, and they have their own infrastructure. So this is in total isolation. You can have the tenancy built. Now a little more advanced, Yes, please. I'd like everybody to hear your question. Yeah.
Say I want to provide a deduplication solution on the cloud. So deduplication means I have some data, but I don't store, let's say I chunk it on every 20 MB and I don't store similar 20 MBs multiple times. So I keep a hash of it. I keep a dictionary with only one copy and Excellent. I keep hashes as pointers. Mm-hmm. So, this hash, would you suggest architecting in such a way that you share these hashes or this dictionary across tenants, or would you, because if you share it, then you save more space.
Right.
And
right.
if you're going to have separate copies, it's not going to really help. So what approach would you take for a dedupe kind of solution?
Excellent question. Again, it's a very, very good scenario. Again, I'm also thinking in terms of cluster environments when we talk about, you have A, B, C cluster servers, and you have a D cluster server, which is a master server for all of these. And in that D is where you'll store your caching mechanism and all that, which is common to all, and then you have, sort of thing. See, this, the decision process in this on how you could actually implement, the sharing out here can be completely a business-driven decision. Okay, you can, as an architect, you can take a choice on, what are the cost benefits or what are the advantages in terms of response times, in terms of transactions, in terms of availability and all these things. So I hope all of you know what is availability. So in terms of all of these factors, you can make a decision on whether I should share this cache across the different instances or across different tenants, or should I hold it for particular tenants. And as I started this session, I told, this is not a formula-based approach. It is a very, very logical, methodical step. Normally, for architecting such things, we always take about 3 months if the project is a year cycle. So you basically go through this entire process, and then you come out with how you decide.
Based on your experience, how much weightage is given to compliance and
Yes. I think based on my experience, I want to also highlight on what we do at IBM. Okay, so I think that will relate very well to you on, whichever organization definitely will have their approach similarly. But I wanted to pick up an example and, walk you all through that to show you how it is done. So this thought process and implementing it via various, there is something called a maturity model that you adopt. So the maturity model will ask you 100 different questions and ask you, do you do this with this cache? Server, do you do the, what is your availability requirements, etc. Everything it will ask you, and finally do a scoring. And then based on the scoring, it will tell you, this is the best thing you can do. And if you do this, these are the advantages that you will have. So, yes.
A2D is for backup and recovery. Deduplication.
Deduplication.
That you could think of as extension to database. You do it, it exists in the database layer.
No, not necessarily. Let's say I want to dedupe only communication between two data centers.
Mm-hmm.
So I use a dictionary hash here, the same dictionary lies there. I don't send the data every time. So it need not be on the database, it can be on the network.
Yeah, it could be on the network, but it sits behind the database. It behind the data, whether the whatever form data is kept, not necessarily database.
It
but
be on raw,
basically
raw data.
You want to replicate. Deduplication is a replication solution, right? To meet some of the compliance
requirements. So you replicate it. So whether you replicate tenant by tenant to different places, or whether you take one the entire data with multi-tenant data and duplicate it, when you are creating the caches, whether you cache them tenant by tenant or all tenants together and keep it. Was that your question?
Yeah, I mean, it's
which is the better?
Also, just another quick point I want to say, we want to come back to the question.
Probably we can go for offline discussion.
It would definitely be good to clarify the thing. I want to just reflect a minute on what the tenant is. So we spoke about what you define as a tenant. So a tenant ideally is a piece of valuable code or software that is, that needs its own secure environment and which is used by a particular thing. It uses resources and it is used by a particular set of user group. Now this tenant, if it is across organizations, it is a very, you know, sort of a business decision that you need to make on whether I need to share this with others. There are a lot of organizations using public clouds these days. Okay, email service is a public service that is given. So do I make this open to everybody and then can everybody use it? Yes, it's a decision that you can make. So similarly, you will need to analyze your situation to see if it can really be applied. Okay, but again, you know, this is not the hard form model. You have other ways you can also implement it. Just moving down the stack here, if you see, there is also called the infrastructure tenancy. So what do we do in infrastructure tenancy? Your hardware, your data center, all that is shared across different customers or different tenants, whereas you have other things dedicated to those, you know, customers who are using your data center. Typically in all our organizations, even for IBM, if I would say, we have different business units within our organization. And all of us use, you know, 3-4 data centers which are there in the US. They all host, you know, services for us, but then we are in an isolated mode. We don't access other, you know, groups of software. So that is in the case of infrastructure tenancy, wherein only if you see this layer here, if you see this box, it is extended out. So this infrastructure is shared across all of the three different tenants, whereas the database is isolated, the application layer is isolated for each of those tenants. Now moving on to the next set, there is something called as application tenancy. We were talking about, you know, whether we should, you know, use the database also shared or what. This, in this case, if there are, for example, you have banking customers, typically banking customers are very, very nervous. We had, we worked for a banking customer last year, and everything you talk, he will question you 100 times. He never trusts architects, because he thinks that, you know, they will just go ahead and implement something and then finally they are exposed to the world. And normally they think the architects are not business sense in nature. So for such customers, in fact, where data privacy is of ultimate importance, they don't mind spending, you know, on whatever the security requirements are there. The third block, the application tenancy, is what will be the best choice. Now going up further down, that's something called as a shared tenancy. In shared tenancy, everything out there is shared. That is the best form of cloud multi-tenancy. Okay? So when you see here infrastructure, database, you will have a single instance of database installed. You will have your own schema. Okay? And the schema would not be talking to each other. You'll be using, in fact, more amount of sharing. You will have the same customer table used across multiple customers. But your data would not be shared across. How is it done? Soni just mentioned that we use what is called a tenant ID versus customer ID combination. So using those keys, you're able to isolate the data within the tables. So that can be possible using this last thing that I showed you. So, yes.
So would you say that architecting a multi-tenant solution is more business-driven, and it depends upon which business you are, you know, catering to? Like, for example, banking customers might be more nervous vis-a-vis, you know, some Salesforce or other kind of business where they're okay sharing data. But in case there is some common application which, you know, addresses different business domains, in that case, do we take, you know, the highest security approach, or, you know, how do we strike a balance?
I would park the question for just a minute. I have a slide for you wherein I can show you how you make the, you know, the decision process. We will talk about that. Okay, we'll also cover security there. So coming to, since we are all talking only around architecture, I wanted to just spend a few minutes, you know, to talk about how do you really architect those four different models of multi-tenancy that we spoke about. So again, a thought behind this, multi-tenancy applies for public, hybrid, as well as private clouds.
it can be applied to any of these cloud models. Again, multi-tenancy applies for IaaS. You must have heard of infrastructure as a service. You must have heard of PaaS, platform as a service. You can apply it to software as a service. So these are all the deployment models that you can apply for. This is an architectural process, whereas all those are deployment processes. And you can cross-match, apply however you want. So coming to the isolated environment, how do you do it? I've just quickly touched upon what are the things that actually makes it isolated. In the case of the isolated case, since most all of the entire vertical stack is isolated, you really do not have to really differentiate anything with a tenant ID and things like that. But what you do at the highest layer, if you see here, the application layer, you can have a tenant ID. It's gone. Okay. I hope you can follow here. For people that side also, you have what is called the tenant ID versus service name. Now you know that everything we talk about today, we talk in terms of service. Okay, generally when you design applications, you always model it as, you model it as a service, right? So in order to differentiate your service from one service to from another and who can access it, you can associate a tenant ID. But a tenant ID is not a mandatory concept here in the case of an isolated tenancy. Moving on to application tenancy, which do you think has to have a unique identifier? Which layer? Database? You have database isolated in this layer. In the application tenancy, what is isolated? Application tenancy, you have the database which is isolated, infrastructure is shared. So when you access your infrastructure, you need to have it, you know, very uniquely identified. Secondly, your application layer is shared. So if you have a WebLogic server installed, WebLogic server should be able to differentiate between the different requests that come to it. So your HTTP requests, when they come itself, it should be carrying something which is unique. Everything is around the tenant ID, the way you design it. Again, the tenant ID can be designed in various ways. Okay, if you have learned about data encryption and all creation of IDs and things like that, it can go into much more detail on that topic. So, but here we're talking about only, how do we isolate? So this is the approach to do that in the case of application tenancy. The highest thing is a shared tenancy. This is where you might want to focus more. That's where what Soni spoke about, the tenant ID and the user ID combination makes a lot of sense throughout the application stack, and without that, you mess up data. Okay, so you as architects need to be very careful about how you model your transactions, how you model your workflows, and how you actually model your, even the UI layer for that matter. Your HTTP headers, everything, what does it carry, how does it carry, otherwise you mess up data. Okay, you lose the confidence and trust of the customer. So given the very little time that we have, I would really like to drill down more into this, but I can definitely talk to you all offline on how we do this. We can probably skip this for this moment. Coming to the question that, your good name please? Ujwala, okay. So coming to the question that Ujwala asked, now how do I make a decision? Should I go with a concept that if my customer is a banking customer, then I give him isolated tenancy? If somebody doesn't care, I give him shared tenancy. That's not the point. But there are, again, as I told you, in a minute I'll show you IBM's approach on how we do it. But then this is a very, very, very condensed way of showing you how we do it. So there are typically some factors that we consider when we actually decide. I'll come to this table in a, okay. So there are some typical factors that affect decision making. So what are the typical factors? These factors that you see are not only technical factors, they are also the CIO worry factors. Okay? So if you see time to market. Now if a customer comes and asks me, okay, I would like to optimize my resources here, how much time would your development team take in deploying that? You need to consider those aspects. Now let's see what it is to do with the decision making. If you see isolated tenancy, it is very short. Why is it very short? If somebody asks for isolated tenancy and they want it very quickly, go get him a box, install whatever database he needs, install the OS, install his application, done. It's done, it's served for him. Whatever legacy application he has, you can take it and put it onto this, it'll start working. Right? So that is a very short, if you see the top thing, it's a very short cycle. It's a very short way of provisioning such an environment. So this could be one driving factor. Secondly, if the same person, has a long time, to make the decision process, you have enough time. It's a 1 year long project, and you might as well think of cost and everything when you design the system, and think in terms of application tenancy and shared tenancy. Now, coming down in this layer, you have to take into consideration what the infrastructure cost requirements are. For this, you'll have to have detailed discussions with all the stakeholders, find out, okay, whether this really makes sense for them or not. I have seen applications where they've gone and optimized it like crazy, and actually they don't care. Okay, they have all the money in the world, they can do it, and they really don't care. So it's a no value add, right? So you need to make those decisions by appropriate conversations with the business users. Next is the economy of scale. Soni also mentioned, how can you scale up and scale down, or scale in and scale out? What does that mean? Scaling not only means how many users you have in the system today versus how many users you'll have 20 years down the line. That is also scaling. Scaling also means in terms of hardware, you know, and software sizing requirements. How many transactions will come, what will be the size of the transaction, message formats, all these things you need to consider. It's a tough job, to say the truth. Okay? Next is, again, economies of scale is more in terms of, you know, what would be the cost implications if you have to change the things later, if you have to scale. Scaling here actually means the technical aspects of it. Next is administrative and management costs. You need to be able to see, provisioning a shared environment is maybe technically sound and a good principle, but then the ability to manage that is another question. I have had scenarios simply in the office environment where in a single box we had installed some softwares, you know, from my team I had installed some software on it. Another team also had installed the software on the same machine. They had their own schema and everything. And one fine Sunday morning we were trying to do something and we find that the whole machine is down. We have no idea why it is, you know, why is it so. And then somebody has shut down that machine because they thought it's only isolated for them. So questions on agreeing upon what is the SLAs, agreeing upon, somebody spoke about what the contract requirements, all of these come into the thought process on thinking on what is the administrative and management policies. Target type tenants, see, most tenants, they would like to know who their neighbors are going to be, okay, because you can have a lot of foul play also happening in this. So that's another factor you need to talk to your business users and find out. Then application transformation. Have any of you worked on application portfolio optimization and transformation and all these things? Anybody has worked on such things? So what does optimization mean? So there are a lot of customers today who come and say, okay, see, we've built these systems from ages before. Today it's not working out, you know, both in terms of maintainability and cost, and architecture is so complex, I want to optimize it. So that is a candidate for optimization here. Transformation means, transformation deals with what it wants to be, say, 15 years down the line or 5 years down the line as per their strategy. So two different business approaches that you apply for, you're making your architectural decisions. And then finally is the coding difficulty. I think most developers would be bothered about this. How much is the coding difficulty here? Do we have a standard programming model today when we talk about cloud adoption? No, not at all. And it's a nightmare sometimes, you know, depending on which code you're working on, whose code you're working on, and how legacy it is. So you need to consider that. We have not gone down this thing, but I'm hoping that all of you can see, you know, how the transition happens. In the case of coding, if you have an isolated tenancy, it is pretty easy. All of us have been doing it right from the time I started off my career, I've been doing isolated tenancy, right? But now if you have to think in terms of shared multi-tenancy, I need to think about how I use my unique identifier separately, how do I isolate my shared resources and all these things. So a lot of design and architectural principles go into shared tenants. So it's going to be a difficult process. And if you have freshers on the team, it's going to be even more difficult because he's going to learn this first time and he'll think that is how application development is going to be. So all of these things you need to consider while making a decision. Although I put this down last year, implications of SLAs, believe me, this is going to create nightmares for you. Every user, every customer wants his SLA up and adhered to. If the SLAs are not met, he cares crap about what you have. Whatever intelligence you put in, you know, creating your tenancy and all these things, he is not going to care. Okay, so SLAs means your service level agreements. It's pretty costly. So if your applications are, you know, you have the availability requirements of 99.98. I don't know what that 0.01 means or 2 means. I have never understood it. But they say out of, I think I asked this question somewhere and they said out of 365 days, your application can be down only for one day. So if you don't meet that, then XYZ has to pay so much money to the other, the customer or whatever. So you need to be very, very careful when it, this has to be in fact up the chart here, SLA adherence. So you need to consider that. And secondly is the containment factors. How efficiently can you contain your business logic, your whatever you use in your system? I hope this chart is useful for you. It's a very brilliant chart, talks so much, but then we're spending we're not giving good importance to it, in terms of the time. So I hope.
Condensed all the factors beautifully.
No, but
a lot of things.
In fact, there's no marketing here. I just want to call it out. But at IBM, we have a very exhaustive process in terms of cloud adoption. Okay, spare me, Malar, okay, for this. Yeah. So if you see
excuse me, I have a question.
Yeah, please.
Yeah, I have a question on configurability in the application and the shared layer.
Excellent.
For especially when you design for different systems.
Yes, yes.
Would you be covering that too?
I feel guilty that I have not put it in here. It's a very, very important factor. So what does configurability mean? Configurability mean how easily can you change your application? You know, if I have a property file, I go and put in all my values out there, anything that is going to change at runtime, and then make your application read the property file and then take that value at runtime and use it, that'll be the best way, because you don't have to rewrite the code, you don't have to pull down your system and have it shut down for 2 hours, 3 hours to have this code deployed. That's the best configurability. So in the case of shared environments, again, as we were talking about the other case, it's a very, very business-driven scenario. Check with the customer what their configurability requirements are. There are customers whom I even work with today who have very clear SLAs. They say, for me, my application can be down for 3 days over a weekend, for two times in a year. So that is very clear for them. And for them to make any small change, they would want it to go through 100 different approvals. So they don't want configurability. They want more in terms of confidentiality management and all these different processes following. But then when configurability is the case, every layer that you decide here, every layer that you work through here, as an architect, you need to put in your brains into it to see, okay, how can you make it more and more configurable? But the more you make it configurable, what are we doing? We are exposing data, right? For easy access. That's the whole idea of configurability. You expose data so that you can easily modify it and have the application use it. So when you expose that, you need to know what your tenant is going to, whether he can look into it or no. So I think that's a good topic, which probably even I have to think through and see how we can really apply. Unfortunately, there have not been much scenarios where we have made our application very configurable, in such cases, in shared tenancy cases. You had some thoughts, please?
Especially when clients need small changes.
Yes.
For example, one tenant wants a workflow to be in such a way and another tenant wants it in a different way. I think that's when the challenge comes.
Correct.
In the shared and the application tenancy, right?
But see,
has there been, I don't see too many examples of designing for such scenarios.
These are all, there are people who claim that these are all age-old concepts. Nobody has really implemented. Today we are talking a lot about cloud. We are going and implementing cloud services for so many people. But still, if you see, a lot of enterprise applications have not really moved to cloud. They're very choosy on what they want to make cloud specific. So probably I'm not in a position now to say, okay, this is the way you do configurability end to end. I will not be able to say. But then if I were given a scenario like that tomorrow, and told to architect it, I probably would go through each layer and understand, okay, what is the level of configurability that's needed. But at the same time, I'll pay double more attention to see how much of security breach it is going to bring about. And then if there is going to be a security breach, I'll go back to the customer and say, this is the problem, so you cannot make it this way. So there's some balance you'll have to do. That's my thought now. Yeah? Okay, security impact is normally, when you talk about architecture and talk about configurability, you talk in terms of property files, so files that you can invoke outside the system. Even your application server and all, they have the admin console which you can access, put in connection pool number and all these things, you can enter it from outside. You don't have to pull down the system to.
But you should have enough credentials to access that configuration, right? So you should have a valid authentication mechanism, and you can actually provide that.
Right. See, credentials, when we talk about it, is for the user. It's for the end user, not for the administrators.
No, for admin also, like, we can have
credentials. We will have. But then, you know, see, we are talking about a... Yeah, just one more minute, I will spend. We'll talk about it, okay? But I'll tell you how the credentials can be overlooked. So let me skip this. I hope this chart was easy. I think we should add configurability into this. So here the idea is, you know, in the case of, you know, there's something called the cloud reference architecture that we use. It's a reference architecture. When you talk about reference architecture, it's a blueprint that we use. And all architects will go back and check with it. It has, if you see these different boxes, they're all different architectural considerations that we use to basically finally decide your cloud application. So in each of these cases, you have templates, processes, guidelines, best practices, patterns, all of that will be provided to you. And it's all done in a very modeling environment sort of scenario that I can go and invoke. So I cannot go wrong, or I cannot deviate from what my organization expects me to do. So these are guiding factors that we use. And similarly, if you see, I'm struggling between two things. So here is where our typical reference architecture sits. You know, it's a very, very, you know, 500 feet high, you know, thing. So Muller wants to find, I understand. So there's a reference architecture. The idea of a reference architecture is basically to give a guideline for the architects on how they should do. So all the questions that come up, okay, how do I do this? How do I do that? Can I make this decision? Half of your decisions will be driven by your reference architecture. I'm sure all organizations have such a, you know, a reference or a blueprint that they can refer to. So similarly here, my goal here was to talk about the reference architecture more, you know, in a little more little detail, you know, talk specifically about our smart cloud, IBM Smart Cloud Foundation and IBM Smart Cloud solutions that we have. The solutions, if you see the last one, the last box up there, it's basically enterprise solutions and, applications that are designed and, you know, pre-made for us, which we can actually dynamically pull in and wire them up together and make a big application. So they're all smart ways of working. So I just wanted to bring that up because they're very... So overall, when you build your services, do I have 1 minute? Okay. So overall, when you build your services, some very, very high level factors that you keep in mind is you normally make your services web service style, you know, services. It'll be using SOAP-based accesses and, you know, visual files and all these things. And all of them will be RESTful calls. All of you know what is HTTP. You know, HTTP REST protocol. So you typically use HTTP REST. And then you will take into consideration other things. You'll take into consideration what are the response times. Your system is used by so many people. Will it respond the way it was responding to you when you were alone using it? No. You will have to have a buy-in on how much response time you will need. So that again comes under SLA, in fact. And then scalability factors, load volumes. At peak times, what is the load on your system? What are the, you know, on your resources? I would not say system. What is the load on your resources? All of these things have to be considered when you make your decision process. Okay, so that's typically about how you decide. Again, we are not doing justice to this topic by talking for it, you know, on it for an hour. In fact, there was a session done in San Jose for almost a week only on this topic. So I'm sure all of you, you know, would be able to go back and read through and gather more information. We'll be there to discuss. All of us, we can discuss offline. So any questions, final questions from any of you?